argument of mine, because I am dealing with a real issue. Gujarat accounts for, and why I'm saying this is because Gujarat also has history. Like Punjab, Gujarat had large migration west, and it was a lot of the earlier wealth that came from the people who went abroad that fueled the growth in Gujarat. Gujarat accounts for only 5% of the country's population, and but 7% of India's GDP. Its share in India's manufacturing gross value added is 14%, 9% in employment, 18.6% in fixed capital, and 10% of total number of factories in India in the 2000s, that is late 90s, early 2000, are located in Gujarat. We are not in any way diminishing the importance of Gujarat as an economically powerful state, not at all. There is no business of bringing down the pride of Gujarat, as those who are critical of Gujarat are told. Every state has its pride and its own legitimate pride for what it has achieved. Like as an Indian, as an ensemble of states, we have pride in this country. Now GSDP growth, now let me go through the others. But all this development was there in Gujarat much before Narendra Modi came on the scene. Point number one. This is not something Mr. Modi came and did a magic wand and suddenly it has all the statistics that is being told. Gujarat's manufacturing sector has grown at a faster pace than all other states in India. Since 1991, it holds the first position in terms of the contribution of the manufacturing sector to gross state domestic product. But however, there is a distinct mismatch in the contribution of the secondary sector, that is other than the non-industrial sector, to GSDP and the employment generated by the sector. Another important dimension of the structural shift is that organized manufacturing is now heavily spatially skewed, meaning in extreme small pockets. I've seen it when I go to Gujarat. People keep on talking of the great roads of Gujarat. Tamil Nadu has much better roads than Gujarat has, and very reliable roads, and the public works engineers of them, of that state, have prevented the state from privatizing roads and privatizing the water supply. And their work has been shown on NDTV as a special documentary on 1 hour. We don't talk about it. So it's spatially skewed. Jamnagar, Vadodara and Surat alone, three areas, account for 60% of the gross value added and output, 64% of the fixed capital in 2005-2006. The employment share of these three districts is 33.1%, 5%, one-third. The districts of Jamnagar, Vadodara, Kutch and Rajkot were the main drivers of manufacturing growth in Gujarat in the 2000. But over the period, especially in the past few years, Gujarat and Jamnagar contribute very little in employment, and Vadodara has seen a fall in its employment share in the recent times. Okay, let me go through a few more statistics. I'm not taking education, health, literacy deliberately, because immediately they will say, that is the lowest states in which ranks in which Gujarat is. Female infant mortality, they are the lowest in the ranking because it's so bad. So on and so forth. I'm not using that. I'm deliberately taking some hard facts. I'll go to, from GSDP growth, let me go to, I'll skip that and go to work participation rates. Was 48.9%. Work participation rates are of the total population, people who are engaged productively in labor. 48.9%, which is the sixth highest in the country. The WPR in the state is less than comparable states like Maharashtra and Tamil Nadu and some other states. For India, the WPR is 45%, is only 48 for Gujarat. The results on rural and urban sectors also show that the work participation in the state are 52.8% and 43.6% respectively. The ranking of the state is not different if you look at the labor force participation ratios. Please remember this. Nowhere does it go up. Matter of fact, in another point in the book, they say they may have got the maximum number of industrial memorandums and higher number of investments. But if you calculate investments to employment generation, Tamil Nadu, Maharashtra, Haryana and all are way ahead of Gujarat. That is, you have to translate investment to jobs. That's your future. Simply saying I've got crores of investment is of no matter if it is not translated to jobs. Now, labor report gives the unemployment rates, okay? Unemployment rate in Gujarat was 9.9%, compared to 9.3% for the rest of India. And for the other states, it's around 5%. So you're hovering not against dramatic figures, but average figures. 2011-12 report does not report any significant change, that is last year's report, in the employment scenario in the state. Gujarat ranks 7th in WPR, 7th in labor force participation rate, and among 15 major states of India. It's still 6-7. Then there is this whole issue of regional growth and spatial inequality, which I just mentioned in the slide. I'm not going to go into it. That's very relevant for states like Gujarat, where we have regions in Karnataka which achieved that. Our state has not achieved all this if we are not looking at regional disparities. And when we talk of state developments and so on, I think we also need to talk about the Kerala model, which Amartya Sen talks a lot. I would say a Karnataka model and a Tamil Nadu model. Kerala model in terms of what has been achieved in terms of health, education, and access to education. Karnataka model because what we achieved in terms of land reforms. We are losing the gains, but we did a lot in the 70s. And a lot of the gains that we have today are the kind of interventions we made in agriculture. And surely there's a wealth of material to be looked at it. Also the Backward Classes Commission and others, particularly in the case of Karnataka and Tamil Nadu, especially Tamil Nadu in terms of reservation policy. Tamil Nadu's reservation policy is much higher than the national average. No educational drop has been found, no fall in excellence. Still today, in the top 10 colleges and universities in the country, Tamil Nadu has 5 or 6. So this is a nonsensical argument that if you increase reservation, quality will come down. There is no empirical evidence for that. Matter of fact, the empirical evidence points to the opposite. So there are these models. Therefore, and let me conclude. I just said take an hour and bought an hour. That we need to be a little more differentiated in our views about economic growth and what we know it as a future, particularly you. And I'll end by saying the implications for development policy basically revolve around the uniqueness of our constitution. If you hear me very often, you might get bored, but I deliberately keep restating it. This, our constitution, is a sacred document, a compact, a sacred compact between the haves and the have-nots. Continuously in our society, there have been elements who have been trying to break this compact between the haves and the have-nots. This discussion about the Gujarat model is another attempt to break this compact between the haves and the have-nots. If that compact is broken, we will be no better than Philippines, we'll be no better than Sri Lanka, and after we start sliding down, it will be very difficult to pull us back. Fortunately, we are not sliding back. Commentators are writing all kinds of stories, if you go to the internet, about how India is sinking, India is in a crisis. Don't take it. Don't get depressed about it. Because everybody is free to write, and everybody becomes an analyst. And if you go to some foreign university, you think that is a label to say our academics are not good enough. So there's no... The crisis will happen when the constitutional principles are broken. The constitutional principles of equality, the constitutional principles of protection, of equal protection, and the constitutional principles that all individuals, all groups are important. And development choice, whichever circle it goes, whoever is the prime minister, must come back to this fundamental cornerstone of this country, that is the constitution. Constitution that people like Ambedkar and all the constitutional writers so beautifully visualized for the future of this country, and which has held this country together through the worst crises. Amartya Sen grew up at the time of the famines. There's some beautiful writings about why he got interested in famine. I was a schoolboy when the food riots of India happened in the 60s. I have never forgotten that. My work on Green Revolution was because of that. You fortunately are living in a world where, because of communication and others, crisis is managed. But crises are not so severe. If we have come 61 years in this republic because we adhered to the constitution, we need for the next 60 years, next 120 years, to adhere to the constitution. And no fake model which undermines the principles of this constitution can take us forward. And that is the fundamental principle for choices for development policy in this country. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. It was indeed a vibrant and insightful lecture. Now the floor is open for discussion. If anyone has any questions.
I could have, I don't have much time to go into it. I wanted to do a lot of interstate comparisons. Chhattisgarh, Orissa, Orissa is way ahead, so on and so forth. I agree, I take this point very well. After all, Mussolini was there, like we did during emergency, during our time. We said, trains run on time. So if you need fascism for a train to run on time, it is that story. And of course, when I used to travel a lot, I used to pay the train person in Calcutta a little bribe to get my ticket. And during emergency, when I went to buy the ticket, he tripled the charge. So I asked him, why? I used to pay 20 rupees, now I have to pay 40, 60 rupees. He said, the risk is greater. Okay? So you learn risk and uncertainty through that. I definitely understand that there is a strong trend towards authoritarianism. I don't deny it. Whether this authoritarianism will become fascist is only you and me can decide. It depends where we make the coin fall. Today is a very thin dividing line. And authoritarianism in my generation, our generation, your teachers, we knew it through things like the emergency rule, the martial law of Philippines, Marcos, and so forth. Where the state openly showed its teeth, it showed its claws. Today, it's much more subtle. We are going through, in my opinion, one of the most serious cultural emergencies of the country. I fear for the culture of this composite, diverse culture of this country. There is fascism on the streets. There's fascism in terms of intellectual opinions. That has to be fought. And that cannot be identified in a sense of state authoritarianism, fascism. This was the biggest problem, even fascism in Europe. When Hitler was building up his forces, then also, I'm not saying I agree with the definition of a weak prime minister. Poor man might have a bad voice, but whether he's a weak prime minister, I don't know. But in Germany, just before fascism, they had one of the weakest prime ministers, and German fascism came up. Now, we have to make a subtle distinction between state factors that produce authoritarianism, fascism, and non-state factors. To me, the non-state factors are more dangerous. It is the non-state factors that cut the dividing line. I don't need to say this in the face of some eminent political scientist sitting here. I see Dr. Umapathy and others. That fascism actually happens when the non-state actors, that is what we call civil society, does not play its role corresponding to the state, and overtakes the role of the state, okay? Starts telling you what you should do, when you can celebrate, who can open, when you can eat non-vegetarian, when you can't non-vegetarian. There's nothing in the laws, but they are going and enforcing this. That is the danger. And I personally, I'm of the view, and I've seen it in my experience, 40 years experience in the region, that it is very important to focus ourselves on civil society fascism. That is a much greater danger. But I'm not avoiding the answer that my friend Sudhir Vambadkare raised. Authoritarianism is increasing, there's no doubt about it. Institutions are also becoming authoritarian. Macro-authoritarianism is creating micro-authoritarianism. micro-authoritarianism institutions, families. Why do you see the sudden spurt of violence against women? That being justified. I've seen a journalist like Jethmalani saying the most awkward things. I hope it's not published abroad about that girl who suffered under Baparam Hazare. That is because under the atmosphere of civil society intolerance, the kind of oppression on helpless people like women and others are happening, children are happening. And there the state is condoning it. The state condones it. So authoritarianism is definitely an issue. It has to be tackled. The second point, the link between authoritarianism and economic growth. Is it a one-to-one relationship? It will be in an unequal society because let me shift from that question to a little earlier. When the earlier on, what we used to have in India in the 60s and 70s, in what in Marxist terms is called the scissors crisis. You know, the scissors crisis, meaning agriculture and industry are always acting as a cutting point in economics. Why? Because in the 60s and 70s, landlords and landlord economy was very strong in the country. So when we had to make industrial decisions, this was a great, for example, the state agricultural prices commission would fix a price for grains, which you put. But the same price when it comes to the states will be made higher. The reason being, the state agricultural prices is looking after its farmers and its landlords. But the agricultural prices commission of the center puts the prices lower based on two considerations. If food prices are lower, wages can be lower. If wages can be lower, profitability can be higher. If profitability can be higher, the rate of return on investment can be higher. So capital sustainability can happen. You know this. It's a very simple, basic rule in economics. But we were in a crisis of that sort. Emergency was a way to which that was broken. If you see what all Mrs. Gandhi did, she broke that nexus. The Kamraj was put out because Kamraj represented the old feudal base of leadership in this country. And a new leadership was brought up and go on and so forth. So the ruling industrial class, it's not only Marx, everybody will tell you, will always want the control of the levers of state. And that is the Gujarat argument, to hand over on a platter while we're all sleeping happily about Gujarat model, to hand over the state. They will always do that. How will they do that? Through what we call the instruments of power, the police, others. If you read The Hindu yesterday, the Hindu editor Siddharth Vardarajan has thrown a bold challenge to the topmost officer of Hyderabad saying, don't try to intimidate us. They were intimidating their journalist. We will not cow down. A paper like The Hindu today has to say this. That danger is there. But that danger can be prevented only if we move away from broad macro arguments about globalization, blaming everything on foreigners, and look at our own backyard. Are we capable of governing ourselves? Can we take off our backyard? My honest opinion is, as citizens, we are not. We can't manage a road. The other day in a department casual discussion, that's the day the UN happiness report came out. And the United Nations happiness report ranked us 111. And I see some of our colleagues smiling. I told them, and then many of our colleagues good-naturedly said, yes, yes, we are very happy. We're a happy nation. So I asked them, when you leave the university and get to the road, are you happy? No, sir, we are not happy. Because it's terror on the roads. That's because of a complete breakdown of law and order, civil society. This issue is very important, but needs to be tackled in another way. Now, rates of authoritarianism are different. Maybe we need to do a study. Which state is more authoritarian? Which state is, if you take labor unrest as one factor, why I mentioned labor unrest is because that is one clear indicator of the kind of fascism that Sudhir Vambadkare is talking about. Because you first attack the working classes. You attack their thing and bring them down. So this is a very complex stuff and I can't want to give simple answers. I hope some sense I answered your question. And you are a good army officer, but you must also be wary of the army when such things happen. Sorry. Yeah.
Normal harmony being activated with the required for that. And now the Say for example, even in accounting at the time, it's a long way, the common people in India are using it is really an insult on us. So you know that is actually when you look at the historical development of India, during the freedom moment that Nehru, Ambedkar, Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel, all these people they have analyzed and built India in such a logical aesthetic, but we are going in a wrong direction, bringing the political force with a feudal environment. How long it will go? And are we giving our democratic system into the feudal lands so that actually we can dismoralize everything and we feel real spirit behind the Indian democracy built by Ambedkar, Nehru, Gandhi and many others? See, now, what would be your opinion on our observation as a chemist? I have made up.
Thank you. The discourse about responsibility should not be used to take away rights, which is often done. When children ask for rights, they are not given the rights, but responsibilities are taken away. But in our society, Harish Kare, I had the paper cutting, I didn't bring it today, a couple of, I think on August 2nd or 3rd, wrote a brilliant article in the Hindu, edit page. We should maybe print it out and put it in our department.
Where he said, while every citizen has a right to attack and ask for the account.